Good morning.
Good morning. Hey, I'm Steven. I'm the education director here. I'm so excited to have you guys back. How you doing? Woo! You got plenty of sleep last night? You rested up? Okay, before we get started, I want to say thanks to the Humana Foundation for opportunities like this. Once again, big round of applause. And also, we're going to be broadcast globally today, live streaming through HowlRound TV. Pretty darn cool, right? So we want to say hi to those folks. And thank you. As well as for questions and comments that you may have, we have to make sure that you guys have one of these when you're delivering that. So Jeff and myself and Betsy, we're going to be running around, so we'll do our best to get to you as soon as we can. And now I think it's time to introduce Idris, fabulous playwright, poet, author, natural teacher, really cool guy. We're so happy to have this relationship with Idris. Currently, you can see his work in Remix 38, right? He's one of the playwrights there with that play. And just a couple of years ago, we celebrated his work, How We Got On, which is like being produced all over the place these days. Really exciting. So, Idris, you ready? Here we go. Idris, Goodwin.
Hey y'all, what's happening?
Hey.
All right. We're gonna do this in a few parts. Well, first of all, thanks for coming out this morning. I know the bed probably felt very nice this morning. And you were like, I'm supposed to be on spring break. Gotta go hear this dude. So I'll try to keep it. Evocative and interesting. There's going to be a few parts to it. First, I'm going to kind of talk about myself and my own work. Then we're going to talk about your work. And then hopefully we can have sort of a back and forth conversation. So basically, this is a conversation about process, about artistic process. And everybody in here, no matter what field of the game you're interested in, you're going to spend some time trying to develop your own process, and it's everyone's is going to be different. So everything I say today is just, you know, I'm still a work in progress myself. I'm still trying to figure out how to do this thing myself. I kind of don't know what I'm doing, so I'm still trying to figure all this out myself, you know, like every creative person. So you know, these are merely things to put into the air, concepts to put into the air to open up some conversation. I might come back a year from now and be like, I was wrong. Sell out. When you see somebody do something good, just be like, I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna do what the other person did. It's like, you know, it's gonna be wolves instead of people. Thank you. That's my speech. Peace. Peace. And I have some written things because I do tend to ramble on like a senior citizen. No offense. It's all love. So I'm gonna start. My name is Idris Goodwin, and that was not always a name I was thrilled about. It took me about 35 years. It was something I'd never written about. I'd never really written about my name until someone just quite simply asked me, hey, you should write a little something about your name. And I want to start here because I think you know, the big headline for today is make it personal. Always make it personal. So this is a piece about my name called Say My Name. I always thought it came out of a book. My mother still has it. It's crude and orange, and the title says African Names. Inside the book, it says something like Idris means immortal, but I don't think that's right. My mother's name is Patricia. My father's name is Don. Their parents, Thelma, James, Ruth, and also James. Their siblings, Alicia, Teresa, Mickey, James Jr., Alvin. They were 1960s Black Power children. They had afros. They wanted to give us some names with throat and vowels. In Detroit, I was a minority. The ladies at my church asked, why you give that boy that African name? Why you gonna give that boy that Muslim name? There are names in the good book, strong apostle names. There are names in the phone book. Strong regular names. In the suburbs, I was a minority. My middle American classmates asked, now is it Idris? Is it Idris? Is it Isidore? Is it Ivan? Is it Iggy? How about I just call you I? How about I just call you E? How about I just call you something other than your name? Age 11, I asked my mom if I could change my name to something else. Mark, Tony, Sean, something else. Being named Idris in North America will arrest people. You must grow patience. That's so unusual. That's mad exotic. It sounds Turkish. It sounds Greek. Are you a Muslim? Age 16, two Arab dudes come through my register. They get big-eyed when they see my name tag. They're curious how the name made its way to a Target in suburban Michigan. They're disappointed when I tell them about the orange book called African Names. Some 10 years later, I'm in the Middle East where they pronounce the name beautifully. Not all straightened and flattened. They've given it a joyful bounce. Idris is a prophet in the Quran. Age 20, I'm new to Chicago. I'm cleaning cigarette butts out of a restaurant urinal for minimum wage. My boss is a big stereotype of a man with like a turtleneck and a sport jacket and some tinted glasses and a thick as Mike Ditka's mustache Chicago accent. He unzips at my urinal, the one I just cleaned, and then he says, I ain't gonna remember that name of yours. How about I just call you Eddie? And my name became Eddie. Until his assistant suggested he stop for fear I would claim cultural insensitivity. The gentleman from the UK tells me the Welsh have a myth. There's Morocco's Moulay Idris, the jazz world's Idris Muhammad, television's Idris Elba. What does it mean? Philosophic cashier. What does it mean? Prophetic cleaner of urinals. How do you say it? What does it mean? Where does it come from? I call myself Idris.
Idris.
It's like my grandma says it, but she's probably not saying it right. Traditions, creators are all beholden in some way to the greats and the so-called greats, canonized and fed to us in school. As we continue to, I said something too controversial. They was like, nah. It's the Illuminati. Illuminati was like, nah, son, not today. Not today, Eddie. Not today. You'll learn that all of my voices sound like that. Like even like, everybody sounds like that. You know, even my grandma's like, yeah. Make you some cookies, baby. Yeah, you like cookies? Anyway, here we go. All right, I'm a professor. All right, here we go. Fetchers in school. Now, as we continue, we all draw from our own memory, the collective memory of our circles, and the collective memory of our country, of our world, blending the past and the present, utilizing the various cultural artifacts of our lived experience, turning them into symbol and metaphor. Which is to say that the past is always there, whether you like it or not. The jazz musician, the modern dancer, the painter, the actor, all develops their own specific mode of looking back and looking forward. Now, in the field of crafting stories, I found the best rule is to always make it personal. And I don't mean autobiographical per se. It's not all about you, but it kind of is. And I believe a regular practice of self-reflection is important. Even as you try to find the truth in another's celebrations and tragedies, the ability to access and find that truth and relate it to your own experience is critical. You guys know that book, Where the Wild Things Are? Okay, so when the author, when they were gonna make that book into a film, the author and Spike Jonze got on the phone and he told Spike Jonze, listen, just make sure it's personal to you. Like, tell your story and use my book as you know, as the landscape, but make sure it's personal. So for myself, the way that I engage in a practice of regular self-reflection was through hip-hop. Hip-hop music and the slam poetry community engaged me in a regular practice of looking back in my own experience and trying to make art out of it. Now, I'm not necessarily here to tell you to all become hip-hop artists, though I don't think that would be the worst idea in the world. But it certainly worked for me. Hip-hop, just for some clarification, hip-hop is built purely on a foundation of cultural relic. And I take my cues from the DJ and the turntablists of hip-hop's analog early days, when one had to tape and splice, completely repurpose technology for one's own means. In other words, it started with the vision, and then the tools were morphed to fit that vision, as were the venues and as were the audience. The DJ's initial job used to just be to let the record play, talk a little bit, and sell products. But in the highly competitive landscape of the 1970s West and South Bronx, New York, you had to stand out. And out of this comes the invention of the breakbeat. A breakbeat is a rhythmic musical loop born from the breakdown section of a funk, soul, disco, jazz, or rock record. Basically, it's the part where like the chorus comes in, and then the bridge happens, and then it just goes down like, it's that, you know that one song where they go, doom, 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 doom. Anyway, you know what I'm talking about. That's dance to the music. That's that Sly Family Stone. Anyway, so that's like a breakdown, right? And the breakdown, anyway. So in the analog 70s, these crafty South and West Bronx DJs isolated the breakdown sections of the popular record and employed a second turntable and this newfangled doohickey called a crossfader to live loop the breakdowns that move the dancers to tear up the floor. A breakbeat is that driving rhythm in which b-boys pop and lock and windmill, in which MCs rhyme, call, and await the response. It's a dynamic crossroad of lemon language and the foundation of hip-hop performance. These breakbeats, pulled from the funk and soul records that spun around my house growing up, were now disfigured and new in an exciting way. They drew me to the page with a furious, reckless abandonment. I was using the straightforward rhyme schemes taught to me through fairy tales and nursery rhymes, but imbuing them with the sounds and the attitude of the day. You guys want a little demonstration?
Yes.
Well, you know, unfortunately, I don't have like a beat or anything. Man, does anybody out here like know how to beatbox anybody? Hey, you sir in the jacket, come on up here. Yeah, you. Hey, give a round of applause for this guy. What's your name, sir?
Brian.
Hey, Brian, nice to meet you, buddy. So you said you could do a little beatbox for us?
I can.
All right, cool. Let's do something.
Hello. Ooty gotti, whatty gotti, whatty gotti, whatty gotti.
Ill rhymes for the day. Real times on display. Word playing with the music for the people to say. This is the art of the tongue and the wind from the lungs. Since man has begun, lyricism been brung. Ever since I was young, to the grave when I go, I'ma dive into that rhythm right along with the flow. Compose a rhyme in my head with the ink or the lead. For the keys, I'ma be writing raps when I'm dead. And best believe what I weave will come out often. I'll be the only MC spitting bars from a cough. Don't call it underground, you can call it deep-rooted, call it sick, because it came up through that soil-polluted rap music. Music and rap and the sound of 2 feet tapping, the sound of 2 hands clapping, and... Launch lyrical beat downs and the fists is the words. The combinations is phrases that I bring to the stages. Rhymes I make for the ages. Help me with earning my wages. All this hate is outrageous. Don't they know it's contagious? You can't ignore these beats because it's what God gave us. So while we panel discussing, I'm there fugitive fussing. The kids is outside making up something that wasn't. It started out with the dozens. Signifying barbecues, barbershops, tall tales, I'm applying. The old rhymes for the week or the month or the year. And if you ain't feeling this, then you must can't hear. Compose a story, any story, graphic, gory, magic, allegories, passion, embellish where they need to be. And feel free to be bombastic, they like Craddock, mathematic, on the mics, whatever come out easily. One more. We're both Hawkeyes, both University of Iowa, represent all day. Ka-ka! That's not the official, no one does that. That's not official. That's not licensed or co-signed by the university in any way. In the process of doing all these theater conferences together, because, you know, Brian's a very in-demand talent, and so we see each other out there in the field at the conferences and whatnot, and we said, hey, we should start a band, and we should only exclusively perform at theater conferences. So, Brian Kehat and I make up the band called The Fantastic Boom. It's not, thank you, God, I could have clapped, but that's fine. That's fine. I don't want, it's not charity. I'm not a charity case. But thank you. The Fantastic Boom is, and we're not just a band, it's more of a movement, really. Anyway, so let's talk about you here. So I have a few things. I watched a lot of TED Talks in preparation for this. And what's big at the TED Talks is people like to bullet point number, boom, boom, boom. So I have that. I have like six things. Little doodads, bits, doodads, little things. So the first thing, and this again, these are the views of myself. The Actors Studio of Louisville does not necessarily, don't make them guilty by association. This is just Idris Goodwin talking. All right, so the first thing is that nothing is sacred. Well, obviously like your family and stuff like that, but like, as far as like in the field of arts, right? Nothing is sacred. And do not waste your time at all chasing the idea of originality. Okay? Nothing is original. Well, the Colonel's herbs and spices recipe definitely pretty original. Now, everything you're doing is a continuation. You're picking up the ball and carrying it further, right? You're taking the torch and you're carrying it until your arms get weak and you gotta pass it off to somebody else. And I'm not necessarily condoning theft or even homage or duplication, but rather repurposement of the pieces in the foundation. The viewer, the beholder, gives the object value. A holy text is paper with symbols on it. The believer gives it value. We make objects and hope that someone will believe in them. And by believing in them, they'll believe in us. August Wilson said we should be writing better plays than Chekhov. And I think he's right. Not to throw shots at Chekhov. I mean, he's dead and everything. It's true. Look it up. He's dead. He's dead. He's dead. Number two. The well of your experience is bottomless. Everything has to be personal. I highly encourage this through writing memoir or essay or personal reflection. As I said, this is what being a rapper did for me. The bad report card, the day she said no, the day I bought those shoes. Seriously, I wrote a rhyme about the day I bought some shoes. In my on-again, off-again forays into recording and distributing music, I made an album called Breakbeat Poems. You can get it on Amazon. Go check it out. iTunes, too. At the time I wrote it, I was living on an apple farm in Corrales, New Mexico. No more of the insane, kinetic Chicago life. I was chilling. And my friends in Chicago said, "What are you going to write about now? Apples?" My friends were kind of jerks. But actually, being taken out of the chaotic environment helped me see clearer the paths and roads upon which I traveled. 3, everything is a remake. Politics, social issues, family issues, personal woes, the clothes, words, and consequences have been altered, but the conflicts are the same. The blues man, the opera singer, and the rapper all use their voice to lament and mourn. We want, we desire, we fuck up royally. We tell ourselves story in order to live. We tell ourselves stories in order to live. And we want another story every night. And just like when we were kids, we want it every night, but a little different each night. Whether or not someone calls you a hack or contrived or cliche is a matter of your execution. 4, embrace the remix. American artists are remixers by nature, especially those of blended culture. Bruce Lee was a remix artist. James Brown was a remix artist. Jean-Michel Basquiat was a remix artist. We're a country in which the entire world is represented. The entire world's influence is within us. And yet we are still developing our own, still recognizing and dismantling the divisions. But we are Americans, and we make remixes. 5, culture is key. You all have culture. You all have stories and legacies. Draw from your culture. In Remix 38, a show I wrote alongside Basil Crimendahl, Justin Kariskis, Amelia Roper, and Jackie Sybil's Jewelry, we utilize bits and pieces from Actor Theater of Louisville's past to create works, much like the beatmaker takes drums from a certain track, horn samples from another track, and pulls them together. I highly recommend you watch the documentary Copyright Criminals. It's on Netflix. Storytellers lift structures, tropes, archetypes, and symbols. 6, read the book Can't Stop, Won't Stop by Jeff Chang. And even though I'm telling you, you don't have to be a hip hop artist, you know, unless you're smart. I'm just kidding. You all look very smart. Although I'm not telling you to become a hip hop artist, I definitely, definitely, definitely recommend you study it. Hip hop is a true mirror of our complicated country. It is brash and idealistic, criminal-minded, spiritual, hungry, and unpretentious. And just like that of this country, traces of the entire world are woven into its fabric. Jamaican DJ culture, Japanese electronics, African drums, Chinese kung fu flicks, Spanish slang, the English language. This is why, when only in its infancy, it quickly circled the world. In just 40 years, there are now multiple generations of formidable rappers, beatboxers, beatmakers, turntablists, visual artists, DJs, fashion designers, and entrepreneurs on every continent and every corner you can imagine. Though I teach hip-hop courses at a college, I am first and foremost a practitioner. Therefore, my main aim is for students to create. And it's deeper than having a fun time with assonant sounds. The true goal is to spark an urgency to represent. A good student of hip-hop will constantly represent for their community, either given or chosen, and represent themselves. On the song Public Service Announcement from his 8th album, Jay-Z begins with the line, "Allow me to reintroduce myself." Even at the height of his popularity, Jay-Z restates who he is, because he knows who he is in constant flux. Hip-hop is concerned with the present, with relevance. A good hip-hop student will draw from his or her personal well and express it with an urgency of the now, express it like someone has a gun to their head. The hip-hop artist, of course, seeks wide recognition, but first must receive validation from his or herself and community. This culture, unlike that of mainstream entertainment, dares you to announce that you are somebody. It is a call for you to talk in your own vernacular, embrace your accent, your big hips, your lisp, your kinky hair, or non-existent savings account. It dares you to mythologize yourself. No matter the images projected by the chart toppers, hip-hop is still a folk art driven by the impulse to seek better and fresher modes of expression, acknowledging and building upon, but certainly not feeling eclipsed by, that which came before. Hip-hop celebrates a vast array of cultural iconography, but holds nothing sacred. After all, this culture started when the DJ touched the record instead of letting it just play as intended. He didn't do it purely out of defiance. The DJ did it because he saw a fresher, better way to get the dancers moving. And the dancers met his gesture with better, fresher moves. It is one of the most beautiful origin stories this country can claim. And now it's time for y'all to tell your origin story. Thanks, y'all, for listening. Yeah, so I definitely would love to hear from y'all now, and we can do questions if you want to do questions, but if you just want to, you know, if you just want to talk or just share a thought that you had during the speech or even this morning before you got here, whatever you want to do. We have someone in the front row, so.
I just wanted to say, coming from the perspective of someone who was born in America, I don't really have any type of like cultural roots that I can really find. I really like the last thing you said, that it's one of the better origin stories that this country has, because it's something that America has created and not just taken from another country. So I thought that was really, really cool.
Righteous. And you know, and I want to say something about this too. I think oftentimes, I'm going to keep it 100 with y'all, okay? I think a lot of times, those who don't perceive to be from blended cultures, which is to say, white folks, let's keep it 100, often feel like, well, I don't, you know, what's my, you know, but to me that's, every artistic process begins with a question, right? Everybody came from somewhere, y'all. Y'all didn't just, like, come out of the ground, like, you know what I mean? Like, just like, whoa. Where's the Starbucks, you know? Double shot, latte espresso with vanilla mist, cinnamon scone, new Bruce Springsteen CD. I can go on this for like an hour. Like, sneakers, DSW. Anyway, I have no idea what I was talking about before, but no, seriously, on the strength, like, that is the work. I mean, you know what I mean? Like, we all got to do our job, right? And I believe, I'm definitely, as I get older, you know, as you get older, the things, like, you actually get over less. Like, the things and the struggles start to, you get more sensitive to things, really, in a way, because you start to understand the meaning of things, the value of things, the older you get, and it gets harder sometimes to let things go. But I think you also get way more optimistic and hopeful as well. And one of the hopeful things that I have is that we really start to get to know each other. This is not about like some Benetton, like we are the world, like, you know, diversity, whatever, but that we really get to know and value all of the different walks and stories, you know, that exist in our nation so that we can own who we are. Like, we all are this. Like, I am also, you know, the Chicano guy in LA. I am also the white dude in Billings, Montana. I am also the Native American, you know, in Arizona. I'm all of these things because these are my people. This is my nation. And so all of our job is to tell our stories. And you do have a story. You do come from somewhere. You know, you may not like it. It may not be sexy or interesting or whatever, but that's your job as a storyteller. You gotta hotten it up. You gotta, like, you know what I mean? Like, wasn't nobody trying, when rap started, like, wasn't nobody trying to hear no, like, ghetto stories? Like, you know, Motown music and all that stuff, it was all dressed up. Everyone was trying to seem more sophisticated. You know, black music was always like, we're showing them that we're sophisticated. Duke Ellington, all these guys were all dressed up and they were straightening their hair and all that. And rap was like, we're here, like we're actually, this is who we actually are, but we're not, there's nothing, there's, look how beautiful we are. Look how beautiful we are. And that's a brave thing to do, and that's what we all gotta do. So you do come from somewhere, you do have something to talk about, and you need to tell your situation, because I don't know it, and I bet it's awesome.
Thank you.
You guys, yeah, you know what you're doing. You were trained at the Mic Institute. You said, all right, when you hand over a mic, you gotta hit it like this. You see what I'm doing?
You guys watch it?
Sorry. I was doing shtick. I'm gonna get my chair. Is that cool if I sit down?
Yeah, that's fine.
Thanks, man. Thanks, man. You know, it'd be kind of fresh if I was sitting here and, like, as I started answering a question, I just got, like, lowered down. It's like, but that's a very interesting point. It's the Illuminati again. Anyway, sorry, my brother. What's going on?
I'm just starting out, and, like, I have, you know, constant, like, uncertainty. I don't know, you know, what I'm doing from, I don't know where I'm going to be in the next couple of years, and I was just wondering, you said at the beginning that you still feel that you're a work in progress and you still feel like you don't know what you're doing all the time. Does that feeling of, like, uncertainty ever really go away, or does it ever, like, I'm sorry for asking that.
No. That's all good, man. I think that's a great question. You guys are doing great on the question front so far. Here's the thing, and this also comes from, I recently became a parent a couple years ago, and no, don't clap, I don't need applause for that, I need a hug, damn it.
I need some money.
No, I'm just kidding. But you start to embrace the chaos in a weird way. You start to take this sort of zen-like comfort in the inevitability of not knowing, and the inevitability of that there will always be uncharted territory, and so you start to just get comfortable, like that's just what it is, that's just life, and that's why you do what you do, you know, that means you're a real artist, that means you care, because you're like, I don't know, like, but you gotta, like, love that curiosity, you gotta love that uncertainty. It's deep. Well, but it really comes just from, you just gotta keep making the work, man. That's it, you gotta keep making the work. Surround yourself with people that you respect, that are smart and whose you know, craft you respect, and just work your ass off, man. Just and know that sometimes you're gonna fail, and that's great. You know, failure is, you learn more from failure than success. Like for me, you know, like I just keep knocking stuff out the park. You know, so like it's really hard for me because like I'm like, man, I'm not like learning nothing. It's like everything I do is like. Is like awesome, you know? No, I'm just playing. Yeah, man. So I don't know if that answers your question exactly, but yeah, just it's a beautiful thing, man. It's a beautiful thing, and it just means you care. The people, you know, the people who don't accept that and like aren't comfortable with that. Those are the people who quit. You know, those are the people who need to know and like just get intimidated by it. You know, so. Yeah. The only artist who never asked those questions and is just completely comfortable is Samuel L. Jackson. Samuel L. Jackson is chilling. He's just like, yep, this is what I do.
Some of the best playwrights in history have written about, you know, very controversial subjects. So yep. I just went kind of wondering, like, what advice would you give us to, like, for playwrights that are writing about controversial subjects? And, you know, a lot of, like, particularly everyone here that's from Kentucky, like, we live in the middle of the Bible Belt, and sometimes you're going to write about issues that people don't want to hear about, and that's hard to deal with sometimes. So I was just kind of wondering, like, how do you deal with that?
Well, I heard some, I Skyped the playwright Christopher Diaz. He wrote the Elaborate Entrance to Chat Deity. I Skyped him into my class a couple weeks ago. He was talking to the students, and he said, he told this little anecdote about when Tony Kushner came in and spoke to his class when he was at NYU, I believe, And he said that Tony Kushner told him, ultimately, all we're doing is writing about relationships. So that's really the thing to focus on. You know, it's like you're writing about relationships first and foremost. And if you always focus on that, it doesn't really matter, like, the milieu of the, you know, that you're working within, that these relationships are taking place in. So as long as you're writing about those relationships, an audience will go anywhere with you. You know what I'm saying? And I always love that. Like, I always love, I mean, one of the things that, like, bugs me a little bit about, you know, really grinds my gears about the industry is there's a little bit of this fear of, people get too focused on milieu. They get too focused on the dress, like what jacket the play is wearing. And to me, the whole point is like, if I can believe in like kings and castles and swords and people speaking in old English, like I'll go anywhere. Like an audience will go anywhere. As long as the play has a foundation of those relationships, you know, we'll go anywhere. We will watch a movie about personified children's toys for, you know, we'll go see three of those movies and be like crying because like that gets to relate. Like, I love that moment in Toy Story 3 where, no, stop fronting, y'all know y'all seen that. Yeah, but that movie made like $500 million by itself. It just kept, it was one guy who went 500 at a time. No, so it's, there's that moment at the end where they're like, I'm a spoiler if you haven't seen it, but I know all y'all seen it. So there's that moment at the end where they're like all in the incinerator, you know, and it's looking like they're not gonna make it, and they just been looking at, they looking at each other, like just looking at each other, they skin, like skin starting to melt, and they're looking at each other like, damn, y'all, we've been through some shit. You know? I love that moment, because it just makes you think about the whole journey you had with these people. So anyway, it's like, that's what we do, like that's our art, like, we grew up on stories about like princes and frogs and dragons on the sky. You know what I mean? That's what we do, and that's, as audience members, we want to go there. You know, so as long as you just keep it about the relationships, man, it doesn't matter. You know.
Hi there.
What up?
Western Kentucky University, and our theater department is putting on a new works festival this year, and I'm doing.
And you'd like me to give you a play? Absolutely, I would love to be here. I've got a stack of great scripts.
I don't have to finish my question. Yeah.
No, just kidding. Sorry. Go ahead.
So I'm doing a solo show. So is my friend here.
Boom.
First foray, and I think Becca's too, into we're not putting on somebody else's work through acting or directing. It's our own work going out there, and it's our own stories. And I am all about stories. I love The Moth. I love slam poetry. I'm all about people's personal stories. And I know that they can be so powerful because when we give ourselves permission to say, this is who I am, like what you were saying, we give other people permission to say, yeah, this is who I am. Mm-hmm. However, I have seen some poets, I've seen some personal storytellers, and I watch them and I say, man, this person's all wrapped up in themselves, and I don't feel let in. I feel like they're just kind of doing a lot of navel gazing, and ooh, this is me, and so when I'm creating this piece, I'm always asking myself, man, is this just pretentious? Am I just full of myself here? How do you find that balance? And how do you make sure that you're always engaging the audience and bringing them into you and that you're affecting them in some way versus just kind of sitting in your own stuff?
Word. It's deep, it's complicated, but really, I mean, I think A, that just comes through just being, just always like really being super critical of the, going back to the purpose. Like, what is my purpose here? Why do people need to hear this story? Because even when you're writing as yourself, you're writing as a version of yourself, an aspect of yourself. You're creating a character, a persona. And so you're not really writing you. You're always writing a character. to a lesser degree, you know. And so it's always being a little bit of that self-critical, dramaturgical critic of yourself as well, like in making sure, and listen, if you have an awareness of that, you're probably not going to participate in that because you're aware, you know what you don't want to do. And that's the first step right there. It's like, I definitely don't want to be like homie over there, you know? And so it just comes from sort of that process of making work and then analyzing the work yourself, you know, having a circle of people that you trust who will keep it 100 with you, you know, it's just process. It's just going to take time to figure out. But also too, it's this thing about execution. It's all about execution. It's like, yeah, like we all have a story to tell, but like, you know, you have to learn the craft of storytelling. You have to figure out effective modes and effective techniques for storytelling. You know, it gets into the execution of it. That's where the artistry comes from, you know what I mean? And, you know, and there are a lot of busters out there, you know? Busters, they walk among us. You know, they walk among us, they suck up funding, they take up space, you know? They're clowns, and you gotta, like, destroy them. With your awesomeness. Your light must push out the dark. Dopeness must push out the whack. Let the church say amen.
Amen!
We gonna pass around the plate.
I have grown up in Philadelphia. I grew up in like a really bad part of, you know, like the ghetto. And hip hop kind of helped me through a lot, and it helped me, you know, develop into the person that I am. And so I wanted to know, like, who was like some, like, your biggest inspirations in like the hip hop community, and you know, how did it help you through things?
Cool. I'm really excited just about Philly. I'm really excited. I got this commission from Interact, you know, Interact Theater in Philly. So I'm really excited. I've never been to Philadelphia before, so I'm really excited to go and work on a play there. The hip hop question, man, it's hard for me to answer because it's not hard for me to answer, but I'm trying not to keep you here all afternoon. I'm a '70s baby. I was born in '77, so hip hop music, you know, as it's sort of grown and developed, you know, I've grown and developed like simultaneously. So. You know, so many artists, you know, along the way. But, you know, I would say right now, I'll just tell you right now who I'm feeling a lot. Maybe that'll be easier. But I really love that Kendrick Lamar album, Good Kid, Mad City. I think it's like such a beautiful like piece of art. Like just as like an album, it's the first album in years that I've had to sit down and be like, because I heard songs and I was like, eh. But when I listened to the entire thing as an album, as an experience, it just like blew my mind. So I'm really feeling that Kendrick Lamar album. I also really like, I'm drawing a huge blank. The Roots are my favorite, you know, Philadelphia again. The Roots are my favorite music group, period. So I always am inspired by them and their work. On the theater tip, you know, Danny Hawk, who did that play Jails, Hospitals, and Hip Hop, a soloist. Jails, Hospitals, and Hip Hop was a huge one for me. Just to see like someone in the theatrical landscape like bringing this sort of hip hop energy into that realm, but not in an inauthentic or like contrived way, like in this very authentic way. It was really inspiring. So yeah, I would say that's the best I got for right now. Yeah. I'm also falling back in love with Notorious B.I.G. too. Just because like I love like he's so good, like his like the first lines of a song. He's like the master of like the first line. You know? It was all a dream. I used to read Word Up magazine or relax and take notes, hot, sicker than your average, live from Bedford Stuyvesant, the livest one. Anyway, this is very exciting to me. Okay, it's fine. Maybe you disagree.
Hi again. Question. When did you feel like you found your current voice, when it really solidified for you in your writing?
See, I feel like that's a trick question, because you're like, when did you find your current voice?
Well, you said before that we're always reinventing ourselves. I didn't want to lock you into something.
Appreciate that. I'll say this. I think artists work in, there's always a new door. Like, you go through a door and you spend some time in a certain room for a while, and then you discover this new door, and then you spend some time in another. You know, it's like when visual artists have their blue period or their cubist period or whatever, you know. You like go through these different doors. And so I would say when I first started working on How We Got On in like 2010-11, that was sort of the beginning of a new chapter for me as an artist. Right now I would say that I'm kind of beginning the process of moving through another door. But that whole time was really about really getting deeper and embracing even deeper, you know, the well of my lived experience, like really to the letter, like really digging into those details and not being afraid of being like, yeah, this is my story. You know what I mean? I think there's a weird thing of being like, no, this isn't about me at all. I'm that brilliant of an artist that like I could write the voice of this, you know, donkey because I'm so, you know, and it's like, no, I'm like, this donkey is my dad. Like, you know what I mean? Like, really, no shots. But like, really, really just like, just really getting into that well of lived experience and like owning it, you know? So that's kind of where I've been in the last few years. How was that? Did I answer that okay?
Yeah,
you
did.
Okay,
hi, I'm over here. Oh.
Wow, that's kind of weird. Don't worry about where I am right now. Where were you last night? Tell the people, be honest.
We want to know. No, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about being a teacher and what you like about being a teacher, maybe what the most exciting thing is for you, and also what's really difficult about being a teacher for you.
Well, one of the things I love about teaching is the students are brilliant. You know, they come up with great ideas, but like they don't, like nobody knows them, so I can like take all their ideas, pass them on my own, and they'll be like, hey, that was mine. And I'm like, I'm sorry, you can't get in. You're not on the list. I have drink tickets. No, seriously, on the real. It's a cliche, but it makes me a better writer, like hands down, because it forces me to. I gotta have something to talk about, so it forces me to like to always be thinking about. Oh, I think I like. You know what? Being a teacher made me appreciate and understand Sarah Rule's writing, whereas like as a playwright, I was just like, no, it's so whimsical and blah blah blah, you know. I'm a Sarah Rule is watching right now, like, what this mother, what? I'm just kidding, Sarah Rule is definitely not watching my eyes. Anyway, but what if she was, though, you know what I mean? She had, like, beef, and it was, like, some hip-hop, like, playwriting beef. So, like, who this man, who, man, you gonna say my name? It's on, son. Hashtag Sarah Rule don't play. Okay, so it's helped me appreciate more playwriting. Like it's broadened my horizon. I've learned more because it's exposed me to playwrights that I'm like, I want to illustrate this technique or idea, and this writer does this brilliantly. You know, so like Sarah Rule's writing taught me all about motif in playwriting, like that she works in these beautiful motifs, you know, which again, like if you learn traditional playwriting structure, it's all this sort of very rigid, very like hyper-masculine, like rigid, like control freaky, Strindbergy, borderline, misogynist, like I'm insane, patriarchal, like, you know, and she instead works in these beautiful sort of motifs that are, you know, more cyclical in nature, you know what I mean, and so, it's just broadened my own horizons. That's one. The other thing is like, you know, just I'm collaborating. I don't look at it as like you are the students and you will sit here and I will tell you what it is. I look at them as collaborators, as fellow artists. And it's like, I've been doing this longer than they have. But to me, it's just like, that's just superfluous. You know what I mean? And so they constantly drop gems. I get excited. You know, I get really excited, like truthfully, when we're like reading their scripts and there'll be a line or a scene or a concept, even if it's a concept not executed well, just the concept is like exciting. Like we had this, I had this student who brought in a play, which was like, it was like this crazy like 1980s style, like cocaine, like caper heist boat, like it was on a boat. It was like this total like femme fatale, Black Widow type main character who was like killing dudes. Like, you know, she had like all the guys were in love with her. She was just like, you're ugly, I hate you, do this for me. And they would do it and she would like kill them when she didn't need them. And we were like riveted, we were so excited. The whole class was like, we were all helping her rewrite it. And like, it, you know, I was like, let's just like start a Kickstarter campaign to like make this play right now. It was tripped out, you know, but we were so excited. And so I love that too. It's just when like everyone just gets excited around an idea, or just in that creative headspace. So I see it as a real honor and a privilege to be able to do it, and to have people put that, you know, that trust in me. So I think every artist should also, I think everybody should teach as well. Like if you make art, to me it's the same thing. You know, it's just it's more collaboration.
Hi, over here. I grew up in the South in Galveston, Texas. There's a lot of stereotypes that come with living in Texas. And you do hip-hop music, and there's a lot of stereotypes that come with that. How do you create work without people interpreting it or falsely installing the stereotypes of your background?
Nothing you can do about it. It's just gonna happen, man. People, you know, listen, I'm going on record here. And I mean this from the bottom of my heart. Some people just gotta die. And they need to take their like whack, archaic, narrow belief systems with them.
Yeah.
That's it. That's all you can do. I mean that figuratively, I don't mean like, and we should speed up the process. Van outside, killing spree, let's go.
Okay, hi, I'm right here, hi.
Hey.
What's up? So you have this really amazing uniqueness about you. This is loud, okay. Woo.
Thank you for saying that about me.
Yeah, and it's so awesome to see, and as a young performer going, soon to be coming out of college, how do you keep that uniqueness and, you know, your charisma and everything, how do you keep that while still, like, allowing the professional world to, like, shape you into a, you know, professional?
Well, you know, I was not always this unique and interesting. It was really a process. No, I mean, listen, you know, when you get out of school, you just gotta be about that life, you know? You gotta just work and like collaborate and, you know, this is a process, you know? And you know, I think just experiencing, being open to things, but also sort of getting to that place where you're able to say no to things, you know, comfortably, and know why you're saying no to them. But also being very open to stuff and really like listening. You know, I'm still learning that. I'm really trying to learn how to be like a better, more present listener and truster of my collaborators, but also be more discerning about who to collaborate with, you know? So I think just being open, being well-rounded, you know, trying to give yourself a diverse experience as much as possible, seeing the beauty in you know, like getting over this thing about like, this is the art that I make and that I like, and things that aren't that art are lesser arts, you know, which is a thing I suffer from a lot of times too. But it's that sort of like, that's your job as a creative person, like, is to be open to all these things, because most people aren't. Most people in the world are closed off, especially in this country. So your job is to be the opposite of that and to bring them into other perspectives, other ways, bring them gently into these other, you know, gently at first, and then being like, pow, your face, son. There's nowhere you can run. I got you. Figuratively. Yeah. I mean, listen, the short answer is just hip-hop. That's what I'm just saying. Study hip-hop and it'll be all right. Yeah.
And Idris, I think that brings us to time.
Okay. Hey, gang. Listen, I'm teaching a master class. It sounds weird to say. I'm teaching a master's class at 12 o'clock. If y'all want to come get your pen game on, it's writing exercises and whatnot. So come to that if you have the inclination or the time. But otherwise, enjoy your day. Enjoy the rest of the festival. I'll see you at some shows. Thanks for listening. Another thing too, if any of y'all, like I work at Colorado College, but like we're in an open relationship, so don't tell Colorado College that though. So if any of you all, you know, whatever, want me to come visit your school and come do a thing or a talk or rap or not rap or listen to you rap, holler at your boy. I'm on Facebook. I got a website. I'm on the Twitters. And all that. Face the grams. Come find me, say what up though. I'm available. Peace.